Here's an exercise we did earlier. If you recall, when I pick this up and drop it, if we look at the values at the left, when I drop the cursor, we take this timestamp right here and we set these to match that timestamp. Now, I would like to take the code that's in here and share it so that, for example, if I were to create a brand new trend, I'm going to do a quick ad hoc trend here, and I were to click this and drag it, I would like to see that same behavior, not just in the one trend, but in all the trends. As you can see here, when I drag this and drop it, it doesn't affect anything over here. And the reason, of course, it doesn't do that is because the code is associated with this object right here. It works for this object, but not for this object. Now, we have an enhanced version. That's the next exercise. In fact, with this version, if I pick this up and drop it, as you can see, that changes, but it also changes if I drop this. And it also changes if I were to create a brand new trend. It's going to do that as well. In fact, there's only one set of code. That code is being shared by all these different objects. So let's take a look at how that works. Let's review briefly that previous example. The existing code works like this. See, here's the trend object. Here's the trend object's drop cursor event right there. And when the cursor drops, we look through all the symbols in the symbols collection looking for values, and if we find a value, we do a set time range. Now, in the new example, we have a few new things added. We're dimensioning variables with events, and we're using an event called SelectionChange. Let's take a look at these two new things we're discussing. Dimensioning with events is a way of, it's a keyword that's used with the dim statement. It basically creates a variable that not only can represent, you know, references to a class ID, to some kind of an object, but it also picks up the events that are associated with that object. And the selection change is an event that happens whenever you change from one object to the next. When I switch by clicking on one trend and then another trend, that's a selection change. Now, let's take a look at our code. What I've done here is I've dimensioned with events a variable called tndx. It's going to be a trend symbol. By doing that, all of a sudden I have this object. It's called tndx, and tndx has all the events that are associated with a trend. Fascinating little mechanism in VB. Let me give you another example. Dimx with events. My syntax is wrong, excuse me. Dim with events x as, how about a ProcessBook object library dot application? This is the application object. Now, by doing that, all of a sudden I have a brand new object called x, and as you can see, x has all the events associated with the ProcessBook object. So it's a powerful little feature. Actually, I don't need that. And the way I'm going to make use of that is now my code, the common code that's going to be shared by these different things, these different trends, the common code is going to be put into the event that is associated with TNDX. And we'll look at that next. If you recall earlier, I said that this example is all about sharing code. If I want the code to be shared, what I'm going to have to do is take the code that's associated with this object right here, tndx, and that is the code, or excuse me, that is where I'm going to put the code that needs to be shared. I'm going to put that in the drop cursor event of that tndx object. Now, once I've done that, all I have to do is make sure that every time I select something new, we assign tndx to be pointing to that new object that's just been selected. So in other words, if tndx hops around from one object to another, that object is going to inherit the events, the subroutines or the procedures that are associated with that object or that tndx. So all I have to do is make sure that as I select one after another different trend objects, that object that is selected becomes tndx. Well, that's exactly what we're doing right here. This is the display set selection change event. A selection change event occurs anytime a new item is selected on the display. Just to demonstrate, let me put in a breakpoint here. And I've currently got nothing selected. When I select this trend, as you can see, that has triggered selection change event. If I go ahead and choose a different item, as you can see, that chooses or that triggers the selection change event. Now the reason this is important to us here is because every time we change this item, at that point we're going to look through all the selected symbols collection. We're going to see if what has been selected is itself a trend. We're going to look at its type to see if it's a trend. And if it's a trend, we're going to add a reference to this variable defined with events. We're going to add a reference to this object that we've determined that's a trend. Now, because this is defined with events, this kind of by proxy, that trend object picks up the events that are associated with this object. Well, one of the events associated with that object is the drop cursor event. That's how we basically get, every time I switch from one object to another, that object picks up all the code. So if I switch from one display to another, one trend to another, each time I switch, as you can see, each time I switch, that's going to execute the code. Actually, I guess you can't see that from here, but if we take a look at our code again, every time I was switching from one to the next, as you can see, as you can barely see here, the timestamps are changing. And that's even going to work if we build brand new trends. If I add a brand new trend, see, by selecting that, that triggers the selection change. So this is now pointing to TNDX. And when I click on this and when I drop a cursor, it picks up those same the same code that's associated with the drop cursor event of TNDX. Now this is a kind of a minor point, but it's interesting to note that when you dimension a variable with events, that can work from an external application as well as internally. What I mean by that is, here's a script in Excel, and this Excel script is actually dimensioning a variable that with events. The variable is going to be pointing at an object that is not in Excel. It's going to be pointing at a ProcessBook object, and it's going to do this so that every time this ProcessBook value gets a new update, a new snapshot value, it'll execute a script here in Excel. The way we're doing this is we're dimensioning with events this val x as a value. And we can do this, the reason we can do this is because we've made a reference in this spreadsheet to the ProcessBook object library. If you go into Tools and then References, you can see that I've gone out and I've browsed and found these two object libraries, or the type libraries, PB symbol lib and PB object lib. I've made reference to them so that we can define these to be that class of object. Now after I've defined them, I then, during the workbook open, I go out and get access to the current open version of ProcessBook by using the getObject command. And I'm looking specifically for a display that's got an item on it called val, excuse me, it's got an item on it that is called valX. A valX is actually the name of the value. So this is not generic, of course. I'd have to make sure that there is an object called valX on that display. In fact, in the gauge example, this is the object called valX. So I'm using this as my active display. And basically what we're doing is we're setting valX, which is defined with events, as a pointer to this object in ProcessBook. By doing that, every time this gets a new value, that will trigger this in Excel. And in this case, it's just doing a it's doing this based on the data update of valX. In this case, it's just putting up a message box. Now, of course, you could have done this another way. You could have put the code inside ProcessBook and then externally gone out and manipulated Excel. But this is just an example. If you've got some long set of code that's sitting in Excel or Outlook or Access, and you'd like to get access to ProcessBook application objects, you can do that. And we feel that the application object, this data update, is a very, very useful mechanism. It's something that most of the ActiveX control containers in the world don't share. That is the ability to trigger scripts based on process values changing.